Tonight we talk about the O.J. Simpson murder trial. It was on June 12, 1994, when Nicole Brown Simpson and Ron Goldman were brutally murdered in the Los Angeles area, that the investigation ensued. We have one of the lead investigators here with us tonight, along with a member of the prosecution team in that famous case. They call it the trial of the century, and I think for all of us that lived through it, we would probably all agree. There was no case that got more national attention, either before or after, than the O.J. Simpson murder trial and the investigation that led to it. So tonight, we're going to go behind the scenes, and we're going to talk to some of the experts about the case, about forensics, about DNA evidence. That was relatively new during the O.J. Simpson trial. And tonight we're going to hear from the experts about how things have changed since then and how that was a landmark case in so many ways. I'm going to turn things now over to our moderator, Frank Bond. Those of us that have lived in the D.C. area for some time know Frank as a past news anchor and reporter for WUSA Channel 9 News for many, many years. He now works with the museum, and he's also with us on many of these occasions.
Thank you, Craig. You know, thank you. About your new museum, it's hard to believe, but 8 years ago, the museum was a hole in the ground. You will be surprised how quickly the time goes between now and 2018. I wish you all the best of luck. Good evening, everyone. You know, it really did live up to that moniker, trial of the century, in terms of the interest. I mean, here we are, all these many years later, still talking about it. And then there was the recent television movie that was made that for which several Emmys were awarded. We'll talk about that a little later, too. I understand one of our guests has another nickname for that movie. But the trial also pointed up the difficulty of trial by jury to render a verdict solely based on the evidence presented in court. There are many players in the bigger drama, and the trial sparked debate on a number of issues, including the impact of cameras in the courtroom, the role of the media in creating a context and then a narrative for what's happening in court, and the attitudes of the American public when it comes to race in determining the fate of a defendant on trial. Detective Tom Lange, you served in the Vietnam with the Marines before joining the LAPD in 1967, staying for almost 21 years. You worked with your colleague, Philip Vannatter, who died about 3 years ago on this case, and it was not lacking for physical evidence. You all went out and combed the site. In your book, you detail how meticulous you were at the crime scene, protecting Nicole's body from view and from being disturbed, because everything at that crime scene had the potential for being evidence. So to start us off, tell us what you thought, and more importantly, what you did when you arrived at that crime scene.
How much time we have?
You've got the floor.
Okay. Initially, we got the call at about 3 a.m. That there was a double homicide in the West L.A. area. I was told by my lieutenant, John Rogers, that they were unidentified at the time and that they'd been stabbed and slashed, and it was kind of a brutal, bloody crime scene. That area in West L.A. is very rare for that to have occurred, especially in a residential area. We don't have a lot of violence or homicides over in that area. When I showed up, it was a little after 4 a.m., and the crime scene had been secured with the yellow tape you've seen. They had Bundy Drive secured. They had the alley behind the residence secured. There were probably 20 or 25 police personnel at the scene. West Los Angeles Division was the primary detectives called out. In Los Angeles, we have 18, or at the time, we had 18 geographical divisions, and each division had their own homicide unit and would be responsible within that geographical area. I didn't work for a geographical unit. Mine was called Homicide Special Section out of what's called Robbery Homicide Division. We have citywide jurisdiction, and we would take over a case that's a high-profile nature, serial killings, things of this nature, because frankly, the other divisions don't have the time to deal with such things. That's all we would do. So the case was being handed over to us because by the time that I'd arrived, they had a tentative ID on the female as Nicole Brown Simpson, either married to, estranged from, or divorced from O.J. Simpson, the football player. So a decision was made at the upper levels of management that we would take the case. So we arrived at the scene. My partner came before me. We were met by the West Los Angeles detectives. And we were described what was there at the scene. And the perimeter had been secured. And what we do at homicide scenes, we have a secure area where everybody can walk through. It's one little path where there is no evidence, where you won't step on evidence, where you're not bound to ruin something or screw up some evidence or whatever else. And this was through the rear of the location. So we're given a tour of what the West Los Angeles people had just to orient us with the case. And then they would turn it over and we would be in charge. So the first thing we would do is make sure we have security around the scene, that the scene is roped off. And we have people assigned, we have people been notified, people en route. We have someone keeping a log of all activities of what everyone is doing at all times. And then we would be given the tour from the rear alley forward through the house and then down to where the two victims were. And as we were taking this tour, the detectives that arrived before us would point out various pieces of evidence that they saw and that they observed. So again, at a crime scene, and there's a lot of law enforcement here that understands this, there are two bodies, they're brutally killed, it's a horrible scene, everything else, but from this point on, you have to look at these two bodies as evidence. They're no longer alive, and it sounds a little cold, but that's what you have to do. You can't psychologically get involved in the horror of some of these murders, because then you take your eye off the ball and you're not really doing what you're supposed to be doing. So we look at this as evidence, these two bodies, and so they're protected like everything else at the scene. Initially, it's pointed out to us that there are bloody footwear impressions leading away from the location towards the west, towards the alley. There's an alley behind the Bundy location, 875 Bundy. It's a dark alley. There's a series of gates along the walkway. We see these bloody footwear impressions moving from the bodies towards the rear, and we did a so-called stride analysis. It's roughly 30 inches heel to toe on the person who left those footwear impressions, indicating to us they didn't run from the scene, they walked from the scene, which is a little unusual. You think two bloody homicides and somebody committed, they want to get out of there. The person who left those footwear impressions walked from the scene. Of interest is when they walked up three or four steps, they went towards the front door, and this person stopped like this. You see the bloody footwear impression stopped, and then they turned around and they looked back to where the bodies were, thinking perhaps, oh, I dropped something, maybe the glove, my cap, whatever, decided not to go back, turned around, and then the footwear impressions continued on through the gates to the alley. Alongside the left side of the footwear impressions, there's a trail of blood. Now, there's six droplets. They tail towards the rear in a westerly direction and are adjacent to the footwear impressions. This indicates to us that the individual, the source, was bleeding somewhere on the left side of their body because, again, the blood tails in the direction that the footwear impressions go. We figure this is a suspect's blood. This is good evidence, obviously. We want to protect that. The bodies themselves, you could tell that they'd been stabbed and slashed numerous times. Nicole was nearly decapitated. You could see her vertebrae from the front. It was evident that she was probably grabbed from the rear and her throat slashed left to right. She was wearing a short shift dress, I guess that's what they call them, a cocktail dress, and she wasn't wearing any shoes. Well, there was no blood on the bottom of her feet, so the first time she was attacked, she went down and stayed down. That was it. She didn't move around. Conversely, the young male, turns out to be Ronald Goldman, he was obviously in a fight for his life. There were defense wounds on his hands. He was slashed and stabbed. His body was off to the side, out of public view. There were wounds evident to his hands where he was probably defending himself and fighting someone off. There were a number of perimortal and postmortem wounds to the body. So he was even slashed and stabbed after his heart had stopped, after he was actually dead. There was a number of pieces of evidence at the scene. There was a dark blue knit cap lying between the bodies. There was an envelope with a pair of prescription glasses in it. There was a set of keys. There was a pager location. There was a glove, one left-handed glove between the bodies. So it's not too hard to figure out. You got a left-hand glove here. There's no right-hand glove anywhere to be seen. You've got someone injured on the left side of their body. There's a good chance that whoever was fighting with these people, whoever attacked these people, lost a left glove, and after that glove was lost, had his hand cut in some fashion, and it was bleeding from the scene all the way back to the rear. Now at the gate, the other side of the gate, we have a round blood droplet, perfectly round, indicating that the source is no longer moving, that the source stopped. Next to this round drop of blood, there's two coins and a little insignia, looks like it's off a child's toy, lying on the pavement. I theorize that perhaps whoever this is stopped and are looking for their keys. That's why the blood is no longer tailing. The source at that point has stopped because there's a circular round drop of blood. And we have two coins, so perhaps the person was going for their keys. The blood drop goes down. They dropped a couple of coins inadvertently. That tells us that very possibly the suspect is parked in the alley somehow and was going for the keys and they left. Various notifications are made. In this case, we had Bundy Drive now blocked off. The main concern before we get into any of this, into the evidence, is that everything is secure, that everybody has a job, and you protect what you have before you collect it. So we need criminalists at the scene. We've asked that the criminalists roll. We ask that when the coroners roll, that they also have their criminalist assist us at the scene, because in the state of California, a homicide investigator cannot even touch a body. You see a lot of this on television where the cops, they come there and they go through the pockets and they look at this and they roll the body over and you don't do any of that. Obviously, most people here know that. You don't try to identify them or anything else. That's the coroner's job. Even if there's a weapon, we can't touch it. That's up to the coroner. Blood patterns are very important at a crime scene. We had numerous blood patterns that are they all tell a story. So we wanted the coroner's criminalist to be there to take the blood patterns from the victims, because many of them were on both victims, on one in particular, Nicole, but they didn't have one available. So this is where one of the most important things, if not the most important thing in a criminal investigation, comes in: coordination and communication. Lack of communication is the bane of any criminal investigation. And believe me, there's a lot of lack of communication. People make assumptions. People forget. They get the blinders on. This is a big problem. And we had this problem initially. The first thing, of course, was the coroner did not have a criminalist. So I have to entrust this, when the bodies are removed, to have them preserve the blood patterns. Now, we were able to photograph them. So we photographed the blood patterns. They were in like a 360-degree angle, tailing in all directions. It tells me that these patterns were probably cast off from a weapon. On the left shoe, on the sole of the shoe, I see another one of these blood patterns. The tails upwards, but doesn't make a lot of sense because the blood was delivered to the sole of the shoe while the victim, Ron Goldman, was down. So we're interested in that pattern because it didn't fit. Obviously, it happened when this victim was down. So you have these similar patterns on Nicole's back. 4 feet, 10 inches away, you have a foot of Ron Goldman with the same blood pattern. I believe it's cast off. I've seen cast off in these types of things. Cast off is when someone is cutting, slashing, everything else, and the blood is flying everywhere, and it tails in this direction, it tails in that direction. So you know, you look at the victims, and you know that you've probably got a couple of dozen wounds, so that would not be uncommon. So we're interested in this blood. I'll jump ahead real quick on the blood. The blood turns out to be a combination of both victims that's on the sole of Goldman's shoe. That tells us that there's one common murder weapon. The bloody footwear impressions are of one type only. The FBI here in town actually identified these footprints, footwear impressions, as Bruno Mali Italian shoes. There's only one set of these footwear impressions at the scene, and they're between the two bodies. That corroborates the one knife theory. The wounds are compatible, which further corroborates the one knife and the one suspect theory. So this is important stuff. Obviously, the one set of bloody footwear impressions with the blood droplets leaving the scene corroborates that. So we have some idea what happened. But this is just the beginning. Usually these crime scenes will last for many, many hours. First call is made to the coroner, and our concern now is publicity. Bundy Drive is a very busy street during the week. This is a Sunday night, now we're into early Monday morning. Pretty soon, in fact, within 3 to 4 hours, there's going to be traffic on Bundy Drive. Bundy Drive is a major thoroughfare between San Vicente on the north and Wilshire Boulevard on the south in West Los Angeles. It's very, very busy, especially on a Monday morning. And we have this thing blocked off. Obviously, someone's going to know something's going on. So we have a decision to make. We open up Bundy. Maybe the media won't get onto it, but that's never going to happen. They're onto everything. Or we misdirect traffic. We have to do something. So the decision is made to open Bundy up. And really, it didn't matter one way or the other because they were going to find out something's going on. Well, they did. And the media started to show up. At this point, we realize that we have Nicole identified. We haven't identified the young man yet. We're ordered to... We're told that it's O.J. Simpson's wife, like you said, or ex-wife. We don't know at this point. He just lives 5 minutes away. They want myself and my partner and two other detectives from West L.A. One of them is Mark Furman. The four of us to respond to this Rockingham location to notify O.J. Simpson that either his estranged wife or his divorced wife, whatever, has a problem. She's no longer living. And we had two children that the police had taken out of the condo at the police station. So it's important to locate him before the media does, to take care of his kids, elicit his cooperation, because we're going to need him. He's not a suspect at this point. There's been a lot of consternation about that over the years. He was not a suspect. Evidence tells us who suspects are, and we have no evidence at this point. The plan is for four of us to go over there. Furman and his partner will stay there. Phil and I will return to the scene and conduct a crime scene investigation. We leave the location, it's secured. The four of us go to... Am I taking too long, by the way?
No, I'm gonna stop you when we get to the right point. Okay. But you're not there yet.
Oh.
I'm listening. We're not there yet.
I hope you're a patient man. We go to Rockingham. It's 5:15 in the morning. We come up Rockingham. It's a very exclusive area of West Los Angeles, Brentwood area. It's a narrow street. There's only one vehicle parked on the street, and it's a white Bronco. It's kind of stuck out a little bit like someone who parked it was in a hurry. It's parked by the so-called Rockingham Gate of Simpson's estate. There's another gate around the other side called the Ashford Gate. Pull up to the location. There are two cars in the driveway. There's lights on inside the home. There's a phone outside for us to call in. And there's a West Tech security sign there. West Tech is a local security outfit that watches these homes. We call in, there's no answer. Call again, no answer. We call West Tech security. They roll by. Actually, before the call went through, one of the gentlemen on patrol came by. And so we stopped him. We told him we needed to get inside, that O.J. Simpson had lived there. Does he have any information or does he have any contact people that we can get a hold of? Because no one's answering. He says, well, there should be somebody in there because we haven't been notified about anything. So I'm thinking bloody crime scene, overkill, personalized. 2 miles away, we have two bloody corpses. We got lights on inside the house. We've got cars in the driveway. We've got a vehicle. I don't like the way it's parked. You guys who are cops out there know what I mean. You got a funny feeling in your gut. Something isn't right. You can't articulate it, but something's wrong. We have a choice to make at this point. The West Tech guy says there should be someone in there. Mr. Simpson never notified us he was leaving town and usually does, or someone does, or his office does. And then they say there's a housekeeper that lives in there. So now there's more concern. Do we have two more bodies inside? So we have a decision. If you're a cop, you make decisions. You don't sit on the stump. You've got to do something here. Later on, to hear this story, some people would think, well, no big deal, just go to breakfast, forget about it, everything's fine. We don't do that. These are what we call exigent circumstances. There's a reason to believe someone inside that house may either be dead or dying. There's a reason to believe O.J. Simpson is in that house dead. There's a reason to believe maybe the housekeeper who's not responding is in the house because we have the cars and the driving lights on inside. Again, we call, nobody responds. We go over the wall. There's a dog, an Akita dog in there. Good thing, he's a very friendly dog. We were very happy about that. We bang on the door, no response, bang some more, holler some more. It's about 5:20 in the morning, no response. We move to the rear of the location. It's a very large estate, and we come across a series of bungalows. There's one to the south, and there's two in front of us. So we knock on the door of the first one. But the first thing we do is go to the rear door, and we look inside, and it's dark. The rear door is locked. We bang on the first bungalow, and it's Arnell Simpson, O.J.'s older daughter. We startled her. We woke her from sleep, you know, in the middle of the night or late, early in the morning. She's startled. She's got four guys sitting there. She doesn't know who we are. We identify ourselves. On private property, waking her up. She's obviously very concerned. She doesn't know what's going on. She's half asleep. We explain that we ask, is your father here? This is another point of consternation, and unfortunately, Arnell had a little memory problem or forgot what she told us and when this came to trial. But I asked if her father was inside. Where's your father, Mr. Simpson? And she said, well, he's inside, isn't he? This type of thing. Later, she denies that. That's another story.
Now, this is where I'm going to hold you up just for a bit.
Got it.
It's a lot of information, but once again, what we've heard is that detectives have been out on the crime scene into the home, so when they get back to their colleagues that are going to assist them in investigating this, this is what they brought back. And this is also why I'm introducing our guests one at a time. I'll introduce them and then let them talk, and then you can associate the role that they played in this and the role that they play with DNA forensics as we go forward. It's kind of a complicated story, even though we all think we know it. Rock Harmon, you were a deputy district attorney and a DNA expert assisting the LAPD in this case. What role did you expect forensic evidence and especially DNA evidence to play at trial in the courtroom?
Well, within 12 hours of what, maybe more, a little bit more than that, Tom was talking about, the first DNA work was done. We can talk about that whenever you want to later on. But I was a prosecutor in Alameda County, so I was sitting home watching the news like everybody was, hoping that guys like Tom, who I'd never met, were doing a good job and being confident that they were. But it became very clear early on that physical evidence was the key to it, even though ultimately people perceived that there were issues about it. So this was I won't say purely a physical evidence case, but if the suspect had been an unknown person, it would have been purely a physical evidence case. The suspect was a national hero, so it became a different kind of case. I can't talk as long as him.
No. Let me follow up.
Not to that question.
Let me follow up because I want to establish early on, what are the capabilities and the limitations of DNA forensics at the time of this investigation and this trial?
You know, that's a great question. I'm sure Jennifer can, because we've known each other since long before that. At that time, we had the capability with the combination of private labs and the FBI of virtually uniquely identified the source of some biological evidence with the combination of stuff. It's a lot faster and more sensitive now. So the potential existed then. We actually had done our first cases in 89, 88, 89, and 90. So it wasn't quite, it was about as new as this suit is. And it's not a new suit because I'm retired. But So it had that capability, especially when the evidence was fresh in adequate amounts. So I was sitting home watching television being totally confident that whoever did it was going to be caught. And I remember going to work the next day, guy walked down the hall and said, OJ's wife was murdered and they're looking for OJ. And I said, what are they looking for him for? Not realizing that a few months later I would be down there being a part of the prosecution team.
Dr. Jennifer Smith, you worked at the FBI for 23 years, overseeing DNA analysis in the lab. You eventually directed that lab. You also testified in hundreds of cases. In July of 2015, you were named director of the Department of Forensic Sciences in D.C. Where were we in gathering, analyzing, and presenting at trial DNA evidence at the time of the trial compared to where we are now?
So, I can almost remember exactly. I was probably had been in DNA typing. I started in 1990 in the FBI lab as a forensic DNA analyst at the time. And this came in when we had a technology. The first technology we were using was actually used in this case. It was something we call RFLP, and it required you had a stain about the size of a nickel, let's say. So a relatively large stain that you could see, and in relatively good shape. In other words, if Mother Nature had gotten to it and started chewing it up, we might not be able to utilize it. But as Rock said, if we had enough, the technology could be applied and we could get a profile and it could be a pretty compelling piece of evidence. Now, if that stain was mixed with another stain, that would complicate things, right? So again, think of larger stains, things like that. We also had new technologies using something called PCR, which allowed us to copy DNA over and over and over again. These were just becoming used throughout some laboratories, and they weren't as informative. So in other words, if you think of DNA like a dictionary or a multi-page book, the early PCR only allowed us to look at one or two pages at a time. So not very informative, but very sensitive, because I could look at very, very small stains. So this case has lots of blood, right? But it's got to be probative, right? So, and you could think, okay, is it probative of, let's say I've cut myself and I'm bleeding on my clothing, so I might have a huge stain there, but at the end of the day, how probative is that stain, right? So maybe these smaller stains are more probative because we're trying to find somebody's blood on something, right? So what they used here, the community actually, I think, kind of banded together and made themselves available to this case. So I think you have to applaud what was done in this case because they got a very good private lab to work with them. They used their state lab to work with them. Now, the FBI did none of the DNA testing. We weren't actually needed. But we were sort of sitting there watching as the analysis unfolded. So we had the technology. But what was still quite controversial were what I'll call the stats. What's the meaning of that profile? How common is this profile? How rare is that profile? And that was still being hotly debated within our community. There were population geneticists on both sides of the argument, right? Are they applying these statistics correctly? And so this case became a trial of DNA, both the technology and of the statistics. And if we fast forward many years later, I'm a professor at Penn State in 2011. And I found that this man somewhere out in California had set his VCR and let it run for the entire trial to include all the little commentary. 7,000 hours. Mm. So I'm at Penn State. And if any of you are Penn State grads, some of your Penn State money went towards buying 7,000 hours. of the OJ trial. And I went through it as a forensic science professor now to see what were the actual testimony about the forensic science, and then what was the play-by-play that the audience got to see but the jury didn't get to see. Because I think that's important. If you were watching this on TV, you heard more than what the jury heard. So you need to keep that in mind. And I told my students, because I'm telling my students that I exposed my students about 50-some hours of this, and they're going, OJ who? Right? It's like 4 years ago. little did I know they'd make a movie about it. So now I'm feeling pretty good. But anyway, so it's a great lesson about how to testify about forensic evidence. And that's how I use this case. So it's fascinating from the investigative point of view, but when you look at it from a forensic scientist, did the scientist deliver that information? So that was also happening in our community. The technology was changing, we were fighting the stats, and then explaining this to a juror. And we took the approach in those days to speak to you for 4 days about DNA till your head exploded. And I don't know if you remember, but Jay Leno was doing some very interesting sketches as this trial was going on. And he actually had the sketch where he showed the jurors, and they're listening to this DNA person going on, and their heads are just getting bigger and bigger until, you know, kaboom. And that was a huge lesson from this trial, that sometimes we tried to make DNA experts out of every one of our jurors, right? So, you know, sort of as a forensic science scholar, I know there are a few of us out there. Anyway, we look at this now retrospectively to say, what did happen and how can we use this? And so this trial, but I would say though, some of you may think the DNA was young or wasn't informative. That's a misimpression. The DNA was actually very compelling information. Maybe it wasn't projected well, you know, and this isn't a fault to the prosecutors, this isn't a fault to the scientists. This is sort of one of those step back and look at it and say, how could we explain this better? And not just the DNA, but the whole forensic, you know, evidence that was laid before them. It's fascinating to look at how it was countered, how it was attacked, how, you know, contamination was the C word in our word, in our world, the C word is contamination, you know. And how is that, you know, brought into this trial? And it's an exceptional case to look at just from that point of view. But as a DNA person, to go back and look at it, the DNA was actually very sound and technically well done for what we could do at the time. I just want to leave that with you guys to think about.
So in the meantime, you can see how difficult a challenge that the prosecution had. But again, this was the trial of the century. So Rock, early on, you tried to head off trouble when you filed a motion against the defense team's plan to have a Nobel laureate testify in court.
I knew you would find that.
whose job it would be to confuse that jury about the reliability of DNA evidence. Tell me about that piece of the puzzle.
About my challenge?
Yeah.
Okay. Are there any lawyers? Well, this is being recorded. That's fine. My lawyer is sitting in the back. It's funny you should ask that. If you want to read how effective I was at getting in the head of a Nobel Prize winner, read his book, Dancing in the Minefield. There's a whole chapter about me in there. So I failed high school chemistry. I had to go to summer school one summer. No, God, you're bringing up so many strange memories. This is a bizarre experience. I mean, when I saw Tom testify for 11 days, right? Wasn't that what you were on the stand?
Only 8 and a half.
Eight and a half. I thought, you know what, not that he didn't do things, but normally when you're the investigator, you're the glue that holds it together. Most of the stuff other people are going to testify about. I realized I was in a different world, and the world down there was just put it on paper, file a motion, let people read it, have fun with it. The judge would never stop you from talking about anything, even though it was all in your papers. So we had I filed a motion saying, I want to be able to cross-examine this Nobel Prize winner, the guy who invented the technology, the technology, Kerry Mullis, about how proud he is to consume LSD. And I had stacks of videotapes of him accepting awards at prestigious organizations and talking about the fractal patterns, watching the sun come through the curtains up in his room that afternoon. So it's not that it wasn't true, but I wanted to ask him, have you taken LSD today? Just because that's something you could ask a drug addict or a prostitute if they're tested upon. So Nobel Prize winners are no exception to that. And then the other part of it was trying to develop his anti-law enforcement personality, did his arrest and conviction for beating up his girlfriend. So, and there it was all over the, you know, front page of every newspaper in the country, knowing two things. One, they were never going to call him because he might have taken LSD that day. And they didn't need him, and they really didn't need him. So there was a very bizarre aspect underneath everything that was going on to the trial. So when Jennifer gave me access to those, I was looking for those moments in the tape that were surreal. And this is my favorite. When I give an OJ talk, it's part of the argument because. I don't know if you saw it, when we argued and the judge agreed with me, I made the comment, oh, well, if we just want to shortcut this, they should just put him in detox for a few days so he can't drop acid before he testified. So that was on the front page of the paper, too. But no, I think it was reflective of how bizarre everything became. Arguments went for hours and hours while the judge sat there and just let everybody talk. It's not the way things were in Alameda County, I can promise you that.
Detective Lange, your partner, Detective Vannatter, had more or less handpicked Marcia Clark to lead the prosecution team because he had worked with her successfully on DNA cases before. As I understand it, some friction developed between the investigative team and the prosecution's team. Talked about lack of communication and missteps. Tell us about the process, because you, as an investigator, you gather all this evidence, you've got your DNA guy to go through it and analyze it, but it's the prosecutors, including Rock, who present it in the courtroom. What were the problems as you perceived them going forward?
I agree with Rock, bizarre. That's a really good word.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Kind of describes it all. Phil had a good relationship with Marcia. In fact, they convicted the first nobody DNA case in the state of California. Mm-hmm. And Marcia was a very intelligent woman. She was a good prosecutor. But I had had a previous problem with her in a previous case involving a murder for hire. It took 8 years to put this case together, believe it or not. Sometimes these cases take a long time. That's why they have our unit. This one, there were a couple of people's lives in danger. And I'd set this case up, and she was going to be the prosecutor, and she went around with me in interviews. We had everything ready to go. Again, it's 8 years old. We have a person who's going to roll over on the suspect. The suspect's a hired killer, total sociopath. We even had him under surveillance at one point. At the last minute, she decides, for whatever reason, and she decided not to prosecute. She pulls a rug out. She doesn't tell me. She tells Phil. Phil tell Tom, I'm not going to handle this case. Well, she's not only jeopardized the case, but the lives of one of the witnesses. I was furious. 3 months later, we end up with this thing. I haven't talked to her since. The case gets dropped. Bad deal all around. Then this thing goes down. Once we got to Bundy, the officers with Thurman found the glove, it becomes a crime scene. So they had to secure that scene, get more people there, another criminalist involved, and a search warrant. So I've lost Phil. Now he's got Rockingham, and I've got Bundy by myself. Mm-hmm. Go back to Bundy, and I start ordering people in, start processing the crime scene, getting evidence set up, the whole nine yards. It's a very long process. Phil comes by, and I don't know this. I know that the glove has been found, but I don't know that other evidence has been found because the sun came up, and there's blood tailing from the rear of the Bronco through the Rockingham gate, right up the driveway, right into the house, and right up to Simpson's bedroom where we have a bloody pair of socks with RFLP mm-hmm. testing. And that Nicole's blood, no question, it's her blood type of thing. So he's got his hands full, but he's got to write a warrant at this point. He can't go any further. And he tells me, I need a DA. And so I said, okay, I'll do the warrant, and I'll be here for, you know, a while. He says, I'm going to get Marcia. And, you know, it didn't hit me right. I didn't want Marcia for those reasons. Because, and this is a personal thing, I'm not going to badmouth her because she's not here to defend herself, but I had a lot of problems with her. I didn't want her there. We're under the gun at this point. The media has started to show up. They've set up across the street. There's about a dozen cameras. They're in a little knoll, which is exactly 115 feet east of the bodies. Mm-hmm. And they're going to start taping our crime scene. Mm-hmm. They're going to tape our evidence. You're going to see it on the 6 o'clock news. You're going to see the bodies, which are evidence. All this stuff, a lot of things are going on. But we needed to have a DA now because we needed a warrant now. Things are happening that quickly. So I relented and said, fine, go right ahead. Now, your question, normally we don't pick the DAs. That's not up to us. Mm-hmm. If we know someone who we have confidence in, who we've worked in the past successfully, you may want to call and see if they're available and see what they think. But that goes through the DA. That goes through their supervisor. Now, Marcia was very competent, very intelligent, very good prosecutor in her own right. We had lots of problems on these cases. Some of us did. You can't think about that. That gets pushed aside. So now we've got her, and you go with her. Mm-hmm. But no, we do not normally pick the prosecutor. That's up to the DA. Mm-hmm. But Marcia was in, and the rest is, as they say, history.
And Rock, tell us about your position. So you've got the DNA evidence, and you know that's going to fit into the prosecution. And as you say, you've got so much. I mean, this could be an evidentiary, you know, prosecution. But tell us about your role in that process, and did your voice enter into the prosecution's plan to take the case to trial the way they would?
You had to put the way they would on the end.
Well, anyway, it's a bizarre case.
Yeah. We were very compartmentalized. I know Tom and I, we, and to the point that, you know, I'm going to share some things here that are kind of fun, but they're not, they didn't make the TV series. the first time we were ever going to really talk as a group, it got canceled because Annie Leibovitz was there. I didn't see you bare-chested in the Annie Leibovitz spread in Vanity Fair, so we didn't make the spread. That's the kind of stuff that preempted the normal course of business, and it was very disappointing to see all of this stuff there, and people not taking advantage of all the help and everything that was going on. You know, there's one point I really want to make that shows you how concerned the LAPD was, probably because it was O.J. Simpson, of not making a mistake about where they were going to go within hours of when he came back from L.A. and they got a sample from him, a young criminalist in LAPD. They were only doing the PCR testing that was available. It wasn't very informative, but they analyzed several of the drops along the walkway. Tom described to you why they were really critical. And while it didn't give you a home run answer, if it wasn't going to be from the guy whose sample you had, it was going to jump out at you. So within 36 hours, you guys knew. I was home watching television at the time in Northern California. But they knew, and this was rushed through, and this was probably, of all the stuff that was developed, it was the most critical moment. Because if that's not his blood, you're looking for the real guy at that point. So the rush was to find the truth, regardless of who it pointed to, not to find him. The challenge, we were very compartmentalized. You had an evidence collection prosecutor, Hank. You had a pathology guy, Kelberg. And I probably learned a lot from listening to Tom's thing, because I didn't get down there till November as the trial jury selection is going on. So it became critical, you know, to coordinate and make sure it fit, if it really did. I think the most interesting part of all of the results that you see, no one, there was no stray DNA of all, and there was a lot of stuff tested. There was nothing that couldn't have been from one victim, the other victim, and OJ, or different combinations of them. And the combinations were reflective of what was happening, like in his car, on the passenger side of the console, was stuff that was consistent with all three of them, or two of them, depending on which one you got. So I heard some people, it sounded like some reaction when you heard that Nicole's blood was on a sock. Without a doubt, it was her blood to the exclusion of anybody that ever lived. Now, you probably wonder, and someone will probably have great questions about, well, what happened? That's a whole other story, but there's an answer to that.
Dr. Smith, I mentioned earlier that you testified in hundreds of trials. When you are testifying about DNA evidence, what are a couple of the do's and don'ts? What are the things you have to do, and what are the things you have to avoid?
So pre-OJ, we actually walked a jury through how the process worked. Because in the RFLP process, often at some point in time, we would put the results up in front of the jury, and you may have seen different depictions. They kind of almost look like a little X-ray film, and they've got bands on them. And sometimes we would actually produce those. And I guess we had in our head sort of this hope that the jury would have an aha moment and see it the way we saw it, right? That was your hope, that the autorad, they were called, would speak for itself. So prior to this, you know, part of my training before I hit the road as a trained examiner to testify was I actually went to, here in D.C., I went down to American University and got a biology class together at night and asked a professor if I could borrow her students, and I presented my testimony, my direct testimony, not about kind of my who I was, but actually the technology. And then I handed out a little test at the end. Now, these are biology students, and said, you know, answer these questions. And when I got the results back, I realized they weren't really following me. So all my great technical knowledge I was sharing with them wasn't really landing, so to speak. And so that's when I started thinking, uh-oh, this might not be the best way to go. And then sort of the OJ trial came along, and we actually had some documentation that maybe that wasn't the best way to do it. Maybe we should do more like the forensic chemists. Forensic chemists get on and say, I'm a chemist. I have this great piece of equipment, and this is cocaine. And you can trust me on that. And they get off the stand, and everybody's going, yeah, that's cocaine. Look at that guy. He's got a bow tie on. I believe him, you know? And so after sort of the OJ, we had this gathering of thought amongst the community and said, you know, maybe we need to keep it simple. And we're just going to get on, and we're going to talk about how qualified we are and how our labs work, and we're proficiency tested. And I have looked at these results, and by and large, it's DNA, and it's consistent with this individual to reasonable, you know, whatever the stats were, right? So we started taking that approach. And by and large, I think that's usually the approach we do now, a more directed, if we're in the trial. Now, if we have to go through an admissibility hearing, it's like back to school for everybody there, including the judge. I mean, if I'm trying to prove I know that this works in the admissibility phase prior to trial, I'm going to do all my PhD stuff, right? But in trials, we took a more simple approach. Now, I'll tell you a funny story. It was actually in California post-OJ decision. I'm in a California courtroom, and I give my little short dog and pony show, get off the stand, getting ready to head back to Washington. You know, it's like an hour later, and I actually get called back by the prosecutor saying the jury's got a question. They want to know more about the DNA. Because they'd been the audience watching the OJ stuff. They'd been the ones getting the play-by-plays, right? So they wanted to know more, right? So occasionally you have to find this balance, but that by and large became the approach of us explaining to a certain degree how reliable the science was and things like that. Because we didn't necessarily, because what was fascinating about this, as I said, they were attacking a little bit of the technology. You actually had admissibility hearings, right? Or some, you didn't have one, but they were trying to push for those. And then ultimately they sort of decided, we're not going to try to keep the DNA out. Right, we're going to let the jury see the DNA, and then we're going to, you know, kind of go down that path and maybe attack the process a little bit. At that time, I believe they used the 1992 NRC report, And so there was a report that had come out by the National Academy of Science in 1992, and it had poked some holes in DNA. It just kind of put it out there. And we used to all carry our little reports around with us with little yellow stickies, and there'd be some comments that usually defense would bring up. And then we'd highlight, yes, but you need to also read on page 42 where it says how great it is, right? So some of those elements were brought out in some of the witnesses. And I think that's why a guy like Rock was there, because Rock had tried DNA cases before. So he sort of knew going into it maybe some of the areas they might be attacking, and so he could prep the witnesses for those. So it was very much in the 90s, in this place and time, as I said before, a really fascinating, you know, almost decision and struggle as to how to convey what we could see as scientists when we got these results back.
So. In the meantime, Detective Lange had another problem, and that was the integrity of the actions of one of your officers. You mentioned him already, Mark Furman, who had made statements that made it easy for the media and others to paint him as a racist and cast a shadow over the integrity of the evidence he had handled. How did you handle that as lead investigator?
Not well. To begin with, we had met Mark Furman. We knew nothing about his past. Mark Furman was never a homicide detective. He's assisted at a couple. He's a bright guy. We first met him. We went over to Rockingham, and he did a good job in following up after an interview with Cato Kalin, of following up on these noises that Kalin had heard on his wall, thinking there was an earthquake. He went back and he found the right-hand glove. He did not plant evidence. He did not plant the glove. Nobody planted evidence in this case. That is a lie that has continued to be perpetuated by defense attorneys on this case to this day. And involving my partner, they waited till he died, and then he said, by the way, he's been planting evidence. I get really upset when we talk about that. Mm-hmm. But this is another story. Furman did a good job at the scene in Rockingham. He found the glove, he interviewed, did good follow-up work. Later on, the defense hired everybody and they started digging into us. I had people that came to my city and tried to do background on me. In fact, I caught one of them one day down the street from my house. And they're trying to, you know, where do I live? Let's talk to neighbors. They went after everybody, and Furman was one of them because he was at the scene and found the glove, which was the initial link between the two locations. Unbeknownst to everyone, he was apparently collaborating with a writer and making this script that he says he was talking to her about that involved the LAPD brutalizing people, racism, profanity, racist remarks, and he's very graphic in describing these things to the writer. Now, when all of this became known, there was obviously a very deep internal investigation. None of that stuff ever happened.
Did he know he was being recorded when he talked to that writer?
My information is yes.
Okay. I never knew that. Yeah.
Well, that's, I was just about to say that.
Yeah.
Why in hell would you be recorded, true or not? It doesn't matter. When someone gets a hold of that and you're a cop, this, of course, is during the case. So his supervisor finds out that he's making these remarks to this woman, this writer, and he orders him, cease, don't do it anymore. This is not going to make us look good. Well, he doesn't listen to his supervisor. He continues to make more remarks, knowing they're being recorded the second time. Okay, so anyhow, they dig this out. This stuff comes out, and let me put it out there. This is not relevant to this case. This is a peripheral issue involving someone who has racist tendencies, who doesn't tell the truth, a bad cop, okay? But that had nothing to do with the evidence in this case and should not have gone into evidence. It's as simple as that. But when he gets braced and now everything turns and Furman is standing there with his pants down around his ankles going like this, everybody gets concerned and everything comes out. They admit two of the tapes. It goes out, and the ending... The end is Furman on the stand with his lawyer standing next to him, and he has asked Detective Furman, have you ever planted evidence in this case or any other case? And he pleads the fifth. Case was over. Mm-hmm. It implodes. Forget it. Let's go home. Mm-hmm. That's the problem with all of that. But that never should have come in.
Rock, what should that bloody glove have conveyed to the jury, and what role should it have played in that trial?
It's a great question, and I try not to be too complicated, because I think if I polled any of you who think you have any ideas about what the evidence means in your questions, it would be a good time to do it. Mm-hmm. Say, well, what do you think was planted, and what do you think was contaminated? And you'll realize that everybody's got a different perception of what they think happened, but even more importantly, what the defense really did. Now, Tom's finishing point there is critical. When a jury makes a decision, they don't have to agree on why they make that decision. They just agree whether it's proven beyond a reasonable doubt. So one person can be persuaded by that, five can be persuaded by contamination, six can say planting. So in reality, I'm going to go back to, this is the Furman glove that we're talking about, the one at Rockingham. The way the evidence was presented was that the glove was planted, but that OJ's blood didn't get on there until this young criminalist, within 24 hours of OJ coming back from Chicago, that when he took some of the reference sample to type it along with the evidence, that the first thing he did was, depending on whose book you read, it was a deluge. The stuff was dripping off the ceiling because it exploded up there. The testimony is boring. I got a little bit on the paper and I changed my gloves. It's routine because there's so much DNA in a tube of blood. And what was the first item that he then processed after that at a different place, changing gloves, was the glove. And then the next items were the blood drops along there. So depending on which version you want to read or which book you read, there was the real killer's blood was there. This is hard. This is like a Chinese menu, no offense intended, with all the different combinations on there. Parts were planted, parts were contaminated. But the theory that the jury heard, the evidence was, they collected the blood. It was a hot day. It sat in the van, and the heat caused the true killer's blood to disappear. This is what the jury heard. This is not my opinion about what they heard. This is what they heard. So, and then in the deluge, when Yamauchi popped the tube there and changed his gloves, he was just transferring it to those blood drops down the line. But I read something else, that Vannatter also had access to those little swatches, and maybe he took the tube that he had from OJ and planted the blood on those swatches and then substituted them somehow in the property room before
Phil was a magician.
That's a different book. Yeah. But I mean, so. The glove had you know, great. It was the mate to the other one. It had the victim's blood, so you got Furman planting the OJ bloodless glove over there. Why would he do that? He must have been brilliant to know that OJ really did it at that time. That would pretty risky behavior, even for a racist cop.
Well, that's bad enough, but when people actually believe that.
No, I agree.
That's even worse.
But you know, to be fair, the last acquittal I had, and you remember, you don't have that many of them because juries usually do the right thing, is when the jury didn't care.
Yeah.
And when they have to sit through all the stuff that Jennifer described, and they've got a guy who you can seem to make a key to it, it's like deflating a balloon at that point. And that's just not an excuse. But when you can't, trying to get a jury to care about convicting a hero for killing his wife after something like that happens is pretty hard to do, regardless of the evidence. It's just easy to say, I don't believe any of this stuff.
Yeah.
I do want to open it up to your questions. Do we have microphones for the audience when they ask their questions, or should they just project? You can project, and I'm going to need a hand to let you know. But first, I want to ask Dr. Smith one final question. Performance counts in a courtroom. It is part theater. I mean, that's the system. And typically, you're not going to have a lot of scientists in that jury box. Is it always going to be an uphill battle for science to come in and have the impact that the facts the prosecution feels should have, or sometimes the defense, quite clearly, because the science is neutral. But whichever way it comes out, the other side is going to be speaking a different language, one that the jury is more familiar with.
So, part of my, profession is to be scientists that can explain our science. We're called forensic scientists for a reason. We know that when we do our science, we are going to have to take it to someone who needs to make a decision. So in a traditional forensic science lab, you're doing your science to help some investigator go forward, perhaps with a case, or perhaps let someone go. So our job is to know our science, but also be able to convey it and what the meaning of that is. So that's our job. And so, that was part of going through this trial and looking at that. I would actually take the live testimony of some of the forensic scientists and show it to my students and say, all right, as you're watching this individual explain, do you have confidence in them? There was one individual who you could tell was so nervous that when they were asked a very simple question, what does a criminalist do, they sort of actually stuttered and stammered through, and that would have been what we call a softball question, right? And this individual, you can see, had not spent a lot of time practicing. And we have to practice. So to your point, it is sort of performance, because you have to not be nervous, you have to convey confidence, and you need to practice that. So that was the message to the students, because if you think about it, most of us are uncomfortable when we have to speak in front of a bunch of people, right? Imagine when you now have to speak about technical things, right? In a way that I actually think jurors are as savvy as they've ever been, right? And people can talk about the CSI effect and all that kind of stuff. I actually believe that CSI helps keep people engaged and involved. They know it's television, and our job is to go in there and explain science. And science, is understandable to people. But we have to be on our game. And so I would talk, and there's a classic. Dr. Bruce Weir was a statistician from New Zealand, brilliant guy, brilliant. But he really struggled with his testimony because he made a mistake. And he got caught. It was actually a true Perry Mason moment when the defense found a mistake in his report. Now, this individual is very confident. He's a full professor, brilliant guy, and he has now been caught on the witness stand, but he wasn't trained as a forensic scientist. Can you imagine? He's caught in front of everything, and he's made a mistake, and it really had an effect on him, right? Those are the things we train about, and if you're good going in and you've got all your things, hopefully they won't catch you in mistakes, but if they do. So a big part of our job is to be able to convey that science in such a way, with the confidence that people, because what's a jury, the poor juror just has to assess whether that person's telling the truth or not, whether they know what they're talking about. And so that's what we make sure we try to do in our job. So to me, it's a big part of being a forensic scientist. So.
Let me read your quote from the LA Times, January 23rd, 2012. In a book Vannatter wrote with his partner Tom Lange, the two detectives credited, quote, a brilliantly pragmatic legal defense team for using a handful of police errors and the racist views of one rogue detective to cause our mountain of evidence to melt down like a cup of Ben and Jerry's ice cream. And that sounds like a bottom line to me.
Yeah, that's bottom line. I think that's what we just said. I agree.
The artist of that is sitting right here, Dan Moldea.
good. Let me find some questions up here from you. Yes, sir. Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, Ed Gibson, retired FBI. I was just a kid when all this trial was going on. But I'll never forget Johnny Cochran when O.J. was putting on the glove. If it doesn't fit, you must acquit. Why did the prosecution allow him to even have that opportunity to put on a glove, which we all know is common sense, that if it had been wet, if it's anything had gotten on it, that thing is going to shrink a little bit. Plus, I can play with it and never get it on.
That for me?
I couldn't answer that question.
A word I alluded to earlier, communication, bad communication on that one. Chris wanted to do that. Chris is a good man. He's a good prosecutor. He felt, I don't know what he was going through his head, and today if he were here, he would tell you he screwed up. If those gloves didn't fit O.J. Simpson, then no gloves would fit O.J. Simpson. My partner, Phil Vannatter's hands were bigger than Simpson's, and he didn't have any problems doing it. Obviously, you have the shrink factor, and for whatever reason, to this day, I don't know why, but anybody who put those gloves on had to be wearing latex gloves. Now, how can you get a leather glove on over latex gloves? You can't. It's like putting glue all over your hand and then trying to slip it into a glove. I never understood that, and nobody's ever answered that. The gloves fit, okay? They didn't fit because he didn't want them to. He was allowed an opportunity to perform in front of the jury on live television. And so you saw all of this and everything else. The proper way to do that is you take everybody back in chambers, and you do it in chambers with the judge, all the attorneys, and if you want to go through this little deal, you do it back there, not in front of a live television audience. That was perhaps the worst moment of the whole case, and if there was doubts in the minds of any of the jurors were laughing. They were like they were at a party because it looked that silly, allowing this guy who was an actor to perform on live television in front of the jury. It was a bad moment.
Thank you for your question. Where's the microphone now? Here we are. Yes.
Hi, thank you so much. You just referenced the mountain of intelligence or mountain of evidence that you had. And if, could you just spend a second or 20 minutes on a little bit more information on if on OJ's DNA at Nicole's house and then Nicole's DNA that you found in OJ's house. Sure. I think that would be really interesting. And you also mentioned you had some concerns about the miniseries. Just if you want to elaborate on that.
Well, I'll let Tom talk about the miniseries because he was in it.
No, I wasn't.
Sure. Starting at the crime scene, those drops along the shoes, those were virtually uniquely associated with O.J. Simpson. Tom talked about drops at his house, going from the car into the house, the foyer, up into the bathroom. Those were all his identified as his. Black socks like these found on a little area rug right next to the bed. We split it up and sent it to two different labs doing this RFLP, uniquely associated with Nicole, but also droplets of blood of his on his socks, too. The glove, as you would expect, Tom explained how violent this whole thing must have been. There were areas that were consistent with mixtures of all three, one or none of them uniquely identified, associated with either of them. His car, the major evidence in his car was on the passenger side of the console. Using the PCR that we were using, which wasn't as powerful as it is today in uniquely identifying people, let's just say there were mixtures consistent with all three people. Now, when you start talking about mixtures, the fact that you're not finding anybody else in there is almost as significant as what you find. And then we did the less sensitive RFLP and showed that it was a mixture between O.J. Simpson and Ronald Goldman. Did I leave anything out?
In addition to the blood, there were fibers, hair.
Fibers, the shoes. The shoes,
there were fibers from Ron Goldman's shirt on that glove, on the Rockingham glove. There was a carpet fiber from the Bronco on that glove. Mm-hmm. Believe it or not, there was a rabbit hair, black rabbit hair. I don't know where that came from. Remember that? Mm-hmm. On that glove. That glove's been a lot of places.
Lining from a coat, maybe.
Huh?
Lining from a coat, maybe.
It's possible. I think maybe you're right. You're right with that.
Wasn't there some hair too, on a blanket or something? Or Rick testified.
No, fibers from the blanket.
So is that what, is that, were you surprised at any of that, or had you known that? Or? I didn't watch the, you didn't see me in there, did you? Or anybody playing me?
Any series has been renamed, by the way. It's the O.J. Simpson Odyssey comic book edition.
You know, we were supposed to go an hour. We've run over. Let's make this the, we're good? We're good? Great.
Thank you. Could you explain the difference between, and you took a lot of grief for this, the interrogation of Simpson, which was actually an interview with Simpson, and what you got out of that tremendous accomplishment that you guys had on that, for which you took so much grief. And then, because you got to know Simpson during that process, could you also just mention your role in trying to save Simpson's life when you got on the phone with him during the Bronco chase?
Is that what they call a compound question?
Yes, it is.
Well, on the interview thing, there's two different ways to interview a suspect. You interview or you interrogate a suspect. In this case, with all this publicity, regardless of how you approach any of the evidence or talking to the suspect, you're going to be criticized or questioned. It doesn't matter what you did. We conducted an interview. An interview is not a situation where you're confronting a suspect with evidence, because we had no evidence. We're talking to Simpson some 11 to 12 hours after the murders occurred. We know that his finger is bleeding, which is very interesting, but we don't know if that's his blood at the scene. So you're thinking there's a possibility. The first thing we noticed about Simpson was he is a narcissist, okay? After we talked for a minute or so, he's bordering on sociopath. A sociopath will not confess to murder, right? Let's face it, they don't do that. This guy has to control the surroundings. We have no evidence to confront him with. So you don't conduct an interrogation. An interrogation is good cop, bad cop. You're going to confront someone with evidence and let them deny it or whatever. If you have nothing and you have a narcissistic personality, you don't dare interrogate someone because they'll invoke. They'll say, hey, I'm here trying to help you folks. I'm trying to give you information, and you're yelling at me. You're this, you're that. I think you're accusing me of this. And he invokes. He's gone. We didn't want this guy to invoke because we not only needed to interview him to attempt to glean inconsistencies, but we wanted to do something about that bloody finger because we perceived that as being evidence. The blood, the wound itself, prints. We need to get something from this guy without getting a search warrant. By the time we had gone through that, he'd be gone. There would be time passed. This finger is still bleeding. You do not attempt to interrogate someone. You don't shoot a gun if there's no bullets in it, okay? So we want him to be one of us, so to speak. So you play along with this type of a personality. Let him think he's in charge. He's a narcissist. So it got very personal. If you listen to the case, it's you and me. Just kind of tell us what happened and go through it. When that interview is through, it's 33 minutes long. And if you break it down, and we did break it down, it's like 13 different inconsistencies and inculpatory statements regarding what Simpson said. Vincent Pugliosi says that he could have convicted Simpson of murder on the basis of that interview alone. There were so many inconsistencies. But that was only part of what we wanted. Again, we wanted his goodwill because we took him upstairs, and we get his fingerprints because we're making latent prints lift at the scene. We photograph his still bleeding finger. Evidence. We take him down to the infirmary, and I say, listen, that looks pretty bad. Let the nurse here take a look at it, and we'll bandage it up. Well, he didn't want that to happen. I said, well, this is embarrassing. I mean, you're getting blood here and there, and by the way, we'd like your blood, too, if there's no problem with that. He said, no, any problem. I'll give you anything you want. All right, if you're going to interrogate this guy, and I'm yelling at this narcissist, how much cooperation am I going to get?
See, let me just jump in, too, because I've never heard...
I was on a roll.
No, but I want to get you further on a roll here. What Tom's really saying, and I agree with this completely, is you can't interrogate somebody if you don't know what happened. Interrogation is a style, but you have to know some truth about it. And I don't know if anybody ever asked you that, but I have a feeling you were pretty surprised when you saw how things shaped up.
Beyond surprised.
Beyond surprised.
Because he's one of
you
us.
Can't, if you, if, I, it's easy to read that and say, what kind of an interview was that? But as I recall, and I haven't looked at it in years, he's bleeding all, oh yeah, I bleed all over the place. Well, I'm 71 now, I bleed all over the place. I'm taking that aspirin that makes you bleed. But OJ wasn't that old then. And so there were pretty laughable attempts by Simpson in that discussion, that interview, well, that were helpful, and the kinds of things that Tom mentioned that he was able to collect in that style.
You get three different stories in a 30-minute interview on how he cut his finger. Mm-hmm. That's what we call inconsistent statements. That's good stuff.
That's
you never saw
stuff.
That in trial.
Yeah,
Marcia had
stuff.
Her own agenda.
Yeah,
you didn't see a lot of stuff. That's the way the title of our book is Evidence Dismissed. It wasn't dismissed by the jury necessarily, it was dismissed by the prosecution. That's another story.
Also the Bronco case, make sure you talk about that.
Okay.
That's that compound part.
That's the compound part.
Wait, is this book going to be a Costco now? Is
that no, Amazon.
Amazon. Or Amazon.
This is pure appreciation.
I agree, yeah.
But just to finish the thought there, because we have his goodwill, I say, by the way, we're serving a warrant at your house. We have to do that because it's part of our investigation. Would you mind coming along? You can come along if you want. Well, I see. Yeah, that's great. I'll see you at your... We meet Simpson at his own house, and he walks me through his closet, and he shows me this and shows me that. He's part of the group now. Once again, if we took the interrogation route, accusing him of things when we don't have evidence, you upset this narcissist. He's not going to go with me and show me anything. So I'm going through the closet. We know we're not going to find a pile full of bloody clothes. He's not that dumb, is he? No. We didn't, but I was interested in footwear because we had those bloody footwear impressions. I said, I asked him, well, you know, can you tell me what kind of shoes you were wearing last night? And he points to a pair of Reeboks. I was wearing those Reeboks. So I picked them up. I said, hey, these Reeboks, because you have a lot of hair. No, those are the shoes I wore last night. So I turned them over and looked at the pattern on the bottom. Clearly, it was not what we had at Bundy. But that's not why I want the shoes. Why would I want the shoes? Anybody?
Size.
Size. Exactly. We knew we had a size 12 at the scene. These are size 12. Talk about if there were exculpatory evidence, and there was none in this case of a substantive nature, if these are size 10, we got a problem. So we booked those as evidence to show that he wears size 12. If we didn't have that cooperation, he's not going to admit to this. So through his own words, through his own admission, he has said, those are my shoes. So that's a piece of evidence that's very, very important. We wouldn't have gotten if we'd treated him any other way. The Bronco chase, Simpson took off 5 days later. He hadn't slept in a while. He was under the influence of something. He slipped away from one of his attorney's homes with A.C. Cowlings, and A.C.'s Bronco. If O.J. does it, A.C. does it, whatever it is. O.J. buys a white Bronco, A.C. Cowlings has a white Bronco. They took off an A.C.'s Bronco to parts unknown because they didn't tell anybody where they were going. Where they went was down to Orange County to the cemetery where Nicole was buried the previous day. When they got down there later, A.C. Cowlings tells us that Simpson had the gun. He took out the gun. A.C. didn't realize it was there initially and was going off into the brush. He was going to kill himself, and A.C. really believed that. He was a little concerned. About 10 minutes passes, and he doesn't hear anything. It's kind of funny, but it's really not. It's kind of sad, too. He didn't hear a gunshot, so he's getting upset now with Simpson. So A.C. goes and he finds Simpson in the bushes, and he says something to the effect, well, are you going to do it or not? They would think. Well, he didn't do it, obviously. So they get back. Let's go back in the truck, and let's get out of here. So they get back in there, and they take off. We're looking for Simpson. He was supposed to turn himself in. We don't like to do business like that. We like to go out and arrest the people. The brass had a different idea. They wanted a dog and pony show because the media was there. They want this big deal going on. He didn't show up. They take off. So there's a press conference, and all of a sudden, the world knows that O.J. Simpson slipped away somewhere in a Bronco. Somebody spots him on the freeway. They call in. It takes about 30 seconds. Before the Orange County Sheriff spot the car and they get on him. You're going down the freeway at about 30, 35 miles an hour, and the deputies see Simpson inside waving a gun, moving it around, putting it to his head, here, there, and the other. AC is on the phone with 911. He says something to the effect of, I've got OJ in the car, he's got a gun, to his head. Stay back. He's starting to panic because he's concerned that this gun is going to be used on Simpson, perhaps. But now we have another concern. You've got the police right on his tail. You've got AC, who's in a panic. And when they get towards LA a little few minutes later, you got all the looky-loos coming up to the Bronco. We're looking at this, and nobody is in control. They're just, everybody is staring at this, and all of a sudden it comes on in the RHD room. We see the chase. The NBA Finals get interrupted. All of a sudden, 60 million people are watching this so-called chase, slow speed. Mm-hmm. And we're looking at it. Nobody is doing anything. Nobody is saying anything. Nobody is trying to pull them over. Nobody is talking to anybody. And so I'm thinking, this doesn't look good. It's almost like a dream. I said, wait a minute, I got his phone number. And his old brick cell phone, he's not going to talk to me, though. Well, he did for about 25 minutes. I kept going in and out of cells, and I kept losing him and kept dialing, and he kept coming back. As long as he talks about anything, his mind is off of that gun that you had to assume is real. You have to assume it's loaded. He's not going to kill himself, AC, the cops, or anybody else. Throw the gun out the window, talk about your kids. We talked about anything I could think of just to take his mind off of the gun while they were en route back to Rockingham, where we set up our people back there and they were waiting for him. We had negotiators and a SWAT unit set up at the Rockingham location. So I talked him all the way back to Rockingham. And as long as you keep someone's mind occupied, they're not going to use that gun. We got all the way back and things ended well, and he put the gun down finally and he walked out. It was just that nobody, again, lack of communication. What are we going to do if something like that happens? You don't train for those things. So you got to step forward and do something. You can't sit on the stump.
Thank you.
Okay. So I have two questions about that. The first one is, can you address the alleged shoot bag that OJ apparently or allegedly gave to an attorney? And the second part of it is, there was a lot of criticism about the judge in this case. What was your thoughts on how that case was handled by the judge?
We'd be talking to any one of us.
Yeah.
You do the suitcase, I'll do the judge.
Okay, good. Yeah, that's good. It was a Louis Vuitton valise is what you're talking about. Think about this. Robert Kardashian, his attorney, had the bag, right? When they came back to the location, he just got off the plane, walked into Rockingham. Kardashian is standing there, and it's on a videotape with this valise. And he's just standing there, and he turns, he walks away with it. There's been documentaries saying that the murder weapon is in there, the clothes are in there. Are you going to come back to the murder scene with the evidence in the bag? No. What happened was there was a half-moon-shaped travel bag that Simpson was found with at the airport unloading. A witness that you never saw in trial was at American Airlines to pick up his wife. He saw O.J. Simpson pull up in a limo. He turns around. His wife is running late. And he turns back around, the chauffeur driver and the red cap had taken his luggage inside with his golf clubs, and this witness is sitting in a low-profile little MG car, and he sees Simpson standing next to a trash container. It's 44 inches high, flat top with four openings, and he's got this half-moon-shaped travel bag on the top. He's taking items out of the bag and not just dropping them, but pushing them down into this trash container. Several items. You think they might have been evidence? You know, at this point, nobody knows the murders have occurred. They don't. The bodies haven't been found. He zips up this bag, this half-moon-shaped travel bag, picks it up, and walks on in to the airport. The witness thinks nothing of this until the next morning. The media somehow gets a hold of Judith Brown, Nicole's mother, who is in shock. Her daughter has just been murdered. They ask what happened last night. She says, well, we went to dinner, and what time? And they said, oh, we had to be close to 11 o'clock. It was 10:45 or something like this. Well, she's in shock. She got the time wrong. phone records show that they spoke the last, because they asked, when was the last time you saw your daughter? And she said 10, 40, 45 or something like this. She got it wrong. Her phone records show it was 9:42, more than an hour before that. But the media went with the first thing they got, 10:45, 10:48, whatever. This is out on radio. This witness hears this, and he says, O.J. Simpson is being talked about as a possible suspect. He couldn't have done this because I saw him at the airport. This witness calls the defense. They know better. They say, thanks, we'll get right back to you. Well, they don't. He calls me 6 months later in the middle of trial where he sees this thing unraveling. And he tells me what's going on. We meet him at the airport with a photographer, do a walkthrough. We find out that there's trash pickups three times a day, go to two common landfills. What are the chances of finding anything 6, 7 months later? Nil, nil, and nil. If you want to know where the evidence was, how about that container? That witness was never used at trial. For the same reasons that we've been telling you, to put that witness on, you got to put me on or someone else who interviewed him. The jury doesn't want to see an L.A. cop on this case because the LAPD was, in fact, on trial. You're up.
So, you know, it's. I don't think it's fair to think that Ito had influence on the outcome of the case, but he sure had a great impact on how long it took. And the, you know, I mentioned jokingly earlier how the lawyers would just go on and on. Did you watch much of the trial? I mean, that's not the way it happens in real life. You get up and make a point in 5 minutes, and then you sit down. And you know, when I first hit the courtroom in November, I was stunned to see him letting people go on and on. Probably the point that I remember sitting there with my partner, Woody Clark, the late Woody Clark, and you remember there was a moment during the trial, and I knew nothing about Ito and his background, where somehow his wife, his wife was a brass at the LAPD. Right. And something happened, internal affairs or something, and we had to pull in another judge to address this issue because his wife was too close to it. And this guy was all business. And I turned to Woody, I said, Woody, if this guy had been the judge, we would have been home like 3 months ago. So, you know, style is all different, personality is all different. But nobody has a right to go on and on the way that trial went on and on.
It, live coverage, everything to do with that.
No, and that's part of the TV in the courtroom.
It also affects testimony.
Yeah, there's no doubt that you're aware of it. You know, seeing the Jay Leno, that was way too late for me to watch during the week there. But there's no, you know. He has his own personality, but it certainly wasn't very good for a case like that. He had every right to put the lid on things and make things happen faster. And yeah, I think that's the safest way to discuss it. Little impact on the outcome, but boy, painful for everybody to have to go through it.
Well. Detective Tom Lange, Rock Harmon, Dr. Jennifer Smith, thank you so much for your insights onto this case.
Thank you
for coming tonight. I think we may be talking about it 20 years from now still.
I hope I'm able to.